number two is evidence of that from the homepage for NPR that when I left my office was still active. 100 years on, the Hello Girls are recognized for World War I heroics. Hmm. And so the story begins in a rehearsal space near New York's Times Square. The cast is preparing for the opening of a musical, The Hello Girls, that's been a century in the making. Very few people have heard this story, said Kara Reichel, director of the production. Reichel hadn't heard of The Hello Girls either until a few years ago. Here's how she describes them. America's first women soldiers, the first women to serve actively in the military, who were bilingual French-English translators who served on the front lines in World War I as telephone operators. How did these brave women make it to the muddy and bloody fields of France for the war's most important battles? The short answer is, and I'll stop here, male incompetence. And yet, in spite of this tremendous military service, the play is topical because as soon as the war ended and the West tried to return to something like normality, because these were women working outside of traditional roles, the expectation is you will go back to the kitchen or the home and do what you were accustomed to do beforehand, and the fact that you demonstrated that you had talent and ability and skill and could do something in a larger sphere, we're not really interested in. The third and final thing I wanted to read a little bit from to introduce the topic is, and Roger, I have to say to you that of all the things I read in my graduate school training, the single short document that has always been at the top of my mind for things I read in graduate school that I cherished was a very short essay, and it's not really an essay, it's a collection of paragraphs that are only loosely connected by a German writer named Walter Benjamin. And it is typically described by the title for the work as a whole, The Storyteller. And so I'm going to read a couple of long sentences just from the first couple of paragraphs. And Benjamin writes, "The art of storytelling is coming to an end. Less and less frequently do we encounter people with the ability to tell a tale properly. It is as if something that seemed inalienable to us, the securest among our possessions, were taken from us, the ability to exchange experience." And then there's a couple of sentences that I'm going to skip over, but they describe the experience of overwhelmingly young men, not young women, who served in the First World War and whose experience in the trenches and on the battlefields bore no similarity to any life experience they had before going to that war. And he writes, "For never has experience been contradicted more thoroughly than strategic experience by tactical warfare, economic experience by inflation, bodily experience by mechanical warfare, moral experience by those in power. A generation that had gone to school on a horse-drawn streetcar now stood under the open sky in a countryside in which nothing remained unchanged. But the clouds, and beneath these clouds, in a field of force of destructive torrents and explosions, was the tiny, fragile human body." I will not make a comment on contemporary politics in substance other than to say we live in times where the challenge of communicating experience to other people of different political views has never been, at least in most of our memories, more challenged. And so, not introducing Roger because he does not need introduction, but to say that this is an amazing chapter in American and world experience, which we are on Sunday going to celebrate the conclusion of. Mm-hmm. I, with you, am excited to hear what Roger will share tonight.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Richard. Good evening. I I am surprised in a way not to be talking about Alan Hancock tonight. But it was my idea that we would do this lecture because of the coming of the centennial anniversary of the war, on, as Richard says, on Sunday. And I'm going to well, how many of you were here 4 years ago when I did the series on the beginning of the World War? Okay, so I'm going to do some of that, but I'm going to change some other elements of it. But before I start, I want to say a couple things. One, I did want to thank Susie, even though she's not here, but also Leslie Mawson and Nancy Meddings and the Friends of the Library who are sponsoring this this whole series. And I hope we continue that in the future. One thing I like is there's no paperwork, which is very nice. Except if you're a student, and I know many of you did, but at the end, if you haven't, just sign your name in there. And if you are here doing professional development for faculty, there's only if you're involved in that, there's another sign-in sheet I was asked to provide for that. That's just everything. All the rest of you civilians, you're off the hook for anything. Okay. I use my... Well, actually, it's... Oh, wait. He just said help. I like professors that had that that voice, those deeper ones. Richard kind of touched on this war is a very strange conflux of the 19th century, 20th century, and actually I would say this is kind of the start of the 20th century for things that went on. I am going to show you some things. It's all black and white and things, but you know, it is war, and war is death and suffering, and so I thought we would look at my cat for a second. This is Quinn when he was a kitten and pretending to be innocent, but as as I tell students, I say, no, cats are witches. And Quinn wakes me up in the morning. I think he thinks he's trying to wake me. I know he's trying to steal my breath and do away with me. But anyway, so there's Quinn. This is a war, and you wouldn't want any war to have a reason to exist, but since wars have happened and do occur, when you look at this war, one of the first things that you might notice if you studied, it didn't really have a reason to start. Usually bad economies bring on wars, or aggression by individuals like Napoleon or later Hitler or Alexander the Great or something like that, political crises. Europe in 1914 was pretty prosperous, fairly stable, had been enriching itself through imperialism. I think everybody knows that there was this assassination that summer, but when you just think, okay, so an assassination led to a global conflict, a teenager with a handgun, in a sense, triggered the greatest war in human history to that point. But underlying it, of course, were many, many other issues. And one of them, in this case, was that Gavrilo Princip was a Serbian person who wanted, like other Serbs, his independence. But Serb is part, if I can go back for a second, part of the Austria-Hungary Empire. Like lots of ethnic groups and individuals, did not have their independence, and so basically made a political statement by assassinating the heir to the Austrian throne, who ironically was actually kind of a political moderate, and had he lived and taken the throne, he might not have been the worst person to deal with the Serbs, but nonetheless, he was killed in, as you see, of course, late June in Yugoslavia. Gavrilo doesn't even live out the war. He doesn't look very healthy in that photograph. He dies in prison of pneumonia, but it is a strange situation to have a single act of violence that would lead to something so large. But again, underlying issues. One is that there were a lot of tensions between a number of these powers, and there were also a lot of alliances, and partly Austria knew, as I just begin this, that if they moved against the Serbs, the Russians, who were really more sympathetic to them, were going to step in, and if Russia rolled somewhere, that Germany would act, and if Germany got on the move when militarily and on, and that's exactly what happened. But the decision really was that people chose to go to war. And oftentimes, when you make decisions like that, you make assumptions that go with it. And in this case, everyone pretty much thought the war would be short and everyone's going to win. And you really don't know how it's going to turn out. That's just the tunic that Ferdinand was wearing when he was shot. So there was competition that came out of imperialism, international competition. There was an international arms race as these countries were developing. If one country gets metal battleships, and we should have metal battleships, and if they've got a million-person army, we should have 1.2 million-person army. There were a lot of conditions that led to this triggering event of the assassination. But some of the most prosperous countries in the world just decided to go to war in 1914. And in a sense, as historians later said, found a way to commit, you know, national suicide in some respects. And the world would never be the same. If I had to pick an adjective to describe the war, I would just say stupid. It was just pointless, utterly pointless. But nonetheless, and dozens of countries would get involved. These are the main ones. It's Germany and the Austria-Hungary Empire and the Ottoman Empire against most everybody else in Europe. And the United States is not involved, of course, until later. Russia will drop out because things go so poorly. And by 1918, they've fallen into a revolution, which will claim more years and millions more lives. and it's just the beginning of the legacy of the conflict. In total, and again, this 19-year-old with a handgun, and eventually 65 million people go off into war. A third of them will be killed or injured, an extraordinarily high number. About 10 million or so will die, and about 20 or so million will be wounded. But at first, there was enormous enthusiasm and excitement, and again, this is a short conflict, and we're going to gain things. Germany had a 31-day plan. They're gonna take France, their typical enemy, and they got within about 25, 30 miles of Paris and got bogged down. But everybody had their plans and went into operation. It is that war, if you know anything. Again, it's a strange mix of the old and the new, of huge armies, but still having cavalry and swords, and those are the Belgians, and they had bicycles, and all that would be going into play. That's the Russian military with the Tsar Nicholas in front of them. Fielding enormous armies was the way Napoleon had done it a century before, and they're still doing that. These are some German soldiers on the march in Belgium in the first part of the war. Belgium's in the way, and they had between they're heading toward France. So all of these large numbers of people are going to be coming into the with modern weapons now that some really haven't been much deployed in war, like tanks and machine guns and flamethrowers and submarines and a whole variety of new weapons. And just imagine cavalry charge on horse against embedded soldiers with an array of machine guns. It's absurd, but that's how the war starts, and that's what happened. And as they say, new weapons, they change the rules of war. You could now drop bombs on people because of the new technology of airplanes, which are only 11 years old. You can be much more effective with the submarines, but submarines can't take prisoners. They also can't warn the ships before they attack them. So it pretty much guarantees more casualties from the new technology. At the same time, there's no sonar or radar. And so what you see there in that upper left with that ship, it was called dazzle camouflage. You still had to visually sight the enemy. And you see what the camouflage does? It distorts visually which direction that ship is pointed, and in fact, is at the front or the side or the back. And you could still basically create an optical illusion for people. These look like giant acoustic listeners. Those are giant acoustic listeners. It's exactly what they're just to try and hear airplanes. It's about as sophisticated as it was at the time. That's an armored train that for moving munitions. Lots of modern munitions, but horses and pigeons and dogs used. Hundreds of thousands of dogs were used. You can see these two, dog and person, have gas masks, as poison gas was a prominent feature of the war. There are radios, but again, it's that 19th and 20th century mix of things. So homing pigeons were commonly used as well. That's a dog hospital there. And this is something that was done not very effectively. It was an attempt to use pigeons for reconnaissance. I know, it looks funny. Cameras on them. Cameras that clicked at certain altitudes. And this was experimental, not very effective. That's one of the photographs taken from one of the cameras. You can see the pigeons. It's like we sometimes get our thumbs in the picture. They got their feathers in the picture. It is odd. But this is, I think, a perfect metaphor for the old and the new as the war went on. One of the defining features of the war is that it became a stalemate rather quickly. And so people simply, millions of people, just dug in and eventually created thousands of miles of trenches where you typically weren't that far from the enemy's trenches. You might even see them. They might be a few miles away, but they might be even closer than that. People didn't want to give up ground. They didn't want to go back, so they just dug in. But this was a war. It was easier to fight defensively than offensively. So they dug in, and then they just continued to shoot each other in many respects for the next 4 years, with not a lot of movement in many cases for these lines. So these became the big weapons of destruction for the First World War. And so then the larger your artillery, the bigger they could be, the more effective they would be in rather static enemy. That's for the comparatively is staying in one spot. So that's a Krupp factory there in Germany. You can see they're just showing you the photograph, the shell and these enormous shells that would be used. The Italian military built 50 of those cannon up there. They're very hard to move because they weighed so much. Eventually, the largest guns could only be moved by rail car, but for this era, these were the phrase being used then, but weapons of mass destruction, that you could shoot at somebody 20 miles away, which they could not do prior to this time, and with the tremendous shells. And you could do that round the clock with thousands of guns, as would be done. This is all the explosive power needed to launch this single shell that was shown. And it's actually an American soldier in that case as they got into it. So factories across Europe started to just turn out unbelievable quantities of munitions, and the United States, although technically neutral, will join into that. There's a lot of money. There's a lot of jobs. As Richard mentioned about women being involved in the United States, well, also in the European theater, certainly. And this is just what you can see is really as far as your eye goes, you just see shells, artillery shells in this one factory. And something like 1.5 billion shells, artillery shells, were produced and used during the First World War. Approximately a third of them, it's estimated, did not explode, but they're still live. And as I'll show you, that's an ongoing problem, even 100 years later. So you could have this kind of, this is taken by a photographer, some timed lapse there to show you the mortars going over the space between the trenches. And this would be just a common feature of existence for those people who were dealing with this kind of thing. Trenches then were terribly risky places to be in. These Germans are practicing using flamethrowers. If you could get up on the edge, so there'd be a lot of hand-to-hand combat, but also, you know, you could have these hellacious devices turned on you. You can see the trench in the upper left is kind of on a zigzag design, and that was to be a little more protective. So if an enemy got, say, with a machine gun, they couldn't shoot straight down all the way down. There'd be a little protection for them. These soldiers really are just kind of camped out in crater shells. Nothing too formal for them. So for a lot of soldiers, digging in was key. Just kind of hunkering down, and the more you could protect yourself and the more barbed wire you could use and the more timber you could have over your head and just kind of living underground in many cases was a lot of what you did. You can see the cratering kind of looks like the moon And you can see the lines of the trenches and this enormous quantity of explosive just absolutely obliterating the land again and again, and people again and again. So for a soldier in the Great War, if you're in a trench, I mean, you're dealing with the weather, rain and mud and heat and dust and flies and just all those kinds of hot and cold things and long periods of boredom. But at the same time, there's snipers looking at you in many cases, and attacks could be imminent, and they might come in the middle of the night. You don't know. And of course, you might be ordered to attack as well. These are some examples of either used for reconnaissance or snipers, you know, artificial trees that look like they've been destroyed, and you have a reconnaissance person in there. This is a sniper with an artificial dead animal that could just move across. And there's some snipers, and you see those German soldiers have, if you can see on their helmets, they have extra plates of metal on their helmets. And so you had to live with this kind of terror of the possibility of attack in various forms, singularly with snipers or in large mass. And as you know, the phrase was of going over the top or leaving the trenches, that of course happened regularly. If you made it across the land, you'd carry things like cutters for the barbed wire. You could very likely end up in, as I said, hand-to-hand combat. So you'd carry these kind of primitive, brutal devices of various sorts to attack your enemy with, you know, handheld bayonets, essentially, with clubs and things that would crack their bones. Just incredible. Soldiers they need to take shovels to dig in, but they would sharpen the edges so they could use those as a weapon as well. I mean, it was kind of medieval, brutal types of fighting that could take place during this thing. And so there's always heroism and courage and remarkable acts of bravery or other things that people did, but for the average soldier, there's a whole lot of just misery that they were dealing with, and life just seemed to be like that. In some cases, you couldn't bury the dead. There were either too many, or the ground was too hard at the time of the year, or it was too dangerous, depending on where you were and what was going on. Or people lost track of your body, which happened, certainly. And frankly, I'm very happy they're black and white pictures. But these are a combination, and these of French and German unfortunates. And you know, outside of a bunker opening, it's a German soldier. Soldiers would talk about, you know, you'd be in an area and you'd see these dead bodies and you'd leave and you'd come back 10 days later and they're just exactly the same. Nobody had attended to them, and for those various reasons, as I said, and the static nature of the battles. The Battle of Verdun is one that stands out for its variety. Viciousness, its duration, its casualties, and it's a small French village that the Germans attacked, and the French decided that they dug in, that they were going to hold this at all costs. And I wanted to show you just a little bit of film about it, about this one particular fight.
Shells have pummeled the French positions. in the Vosges can hear the bombardment. For their attack on Verdun, the Germans deploy a terrifying weapon, the flamethrower. They break through the French lines and enter the Corps forest, where the trees have been blasted by shells. Here, the Germans encounter unexpected resistance from the French soldiers who survived the barrage. Stormtroopers. Shaken, the French general staff decide to defend Verdun to the end. A new commander is named, General Philippe Pétain, who has remained on the sidelines. The 60-year-old general is known to oppose the French strategy of offense at all costs, and he implements a defensive strategy. His orders are to dig in and hold on. The French stop the German advance. The battlefield becomes a slaughterhouse. Verdun survivor and winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature, Jean Giono, later writes, "We are nine in a hole. Nothing will get us out of here. But we have eaten. We must relieve ourselves. The first of us to feel the urge climbs out. He has been there for 2 days now, 10 feet away, killed, with his trousers down. We crap on paper and throw it up and out. When we have no more paper, we go in our haversacks. The Battle of Verdun continues. We go in our hands. Dysentery flows between our fingers. We crap blood. We go where we lie. We are devoured by flames of thirst. We drink our own urine. If we remain on this battlefield, it is because they won't let us get away."
It's not a reenactment. It's colorized film, though. It was film from there wasn't color. There was experimental color photography, but not in moving pictures. But colorizing, I've long resisted it, but it's gotten so much better. But this is out of a long series on the war. But just a sense of, I mean, you could die going to the bathroom, but you had to go to the bathroom. And Verdun is, as I said, known for this intense, it was nearly a year-long, 10-month-long battle. Nearly a million people died in this village, where they estimate 54 million shells were just fired at each other. They were bringing in train loads of shells day after day and train loads of people. And the French held on to the village at the cost of a combined million lives. It's incredible. And I think the extract from this lieutenant's diary is accurate. He was later killed in the battles, that people have gone mad to do this. I mean, to just fight over a village for all these months, and gas was used as well. For what purpose? And it was just this decision. And you think of these officers who were trained in the 1800s in most cases, and different tactics with different weapons, and now they're employing this and this. Kind of, we're not going to lose this. We're not going to go backwards at such a huge cost. And so, as we have in all wars, some people do go mad. In the Civil War, they didn't understand it. The American Civil War, and sometimes it was called cowardice. And in this war, it was shell shock. And World War II, it was sometimes battle fatigue. I think we all know what it is. Was it? post-traumatic stress disorder, which you don't have to go through war to have, but some kind of condition or situation, some kind of experience that is simply beyond your capacity to rationally grapple with. And it wasn't always understood even in this war. John Hines was a British soldier who became obsessed with collecting souvenirs or relics from dead soldiers. He became, in a very kind of sad way, something of a celebrity after the war in England, in that, you know, this man had all of these strange things in his behaviors. He was clearly in need of a great deal of treatment. He was essentially homeless after the war. But there were thousands of John Hines of all sorts. These are the emotionally wounded, the people who have not been physically wounded, but they sometimes couldn't speak, they couldn't walk, they couldn't rationally explain things, and it was a mystery, and there was this people like Charles Myers and others began to study these people more to figure out or try and figure out what to do with them. I want to play a little section about this. This is from a series simply called The Great War. It's a very good series and has footage that's not that common.
Only in November,
a few seconds talking
when the
about
weather
the
turned bad, did Haig call off the battle. The Allied army had advanced exactly 6 miles. 4 miles short of the objective Haig's cavalry had hoped to take on the opening day. Just like Verdun, the Battle of the Somme resulted in 1 million casualties. And the battle lines hardly changed at all. Shell shock represented a kind of mutiny, a personal withdrawal from an intolerable reality. Not all, or even most soldiers, suffered from shell shock. But those who did were sobering examples of what mechanized warfare could do to human beings.
Rifleman Arthur Russell was, or had been, a magnificent specimen of manhood, 6 feet tall. There was not a mark on him, yet he was helpless as a child. When I returned about a month later, I found Russell trying to walk. His speech was slowly returning, a slow, halting speech full of stammers. But I doubt if he ever again became a fully fit man.
The symptoms were often tied to an event on the battlefield. The soldier who bayoneted an enemy in the face developed a facial tic. This man responded to nothing, except the word bomb, which sent him scurrying under the bed. This French soldier became hysterical at the sight of an officer's red hat. Treatment for most enlisted men involved rest and recuperation.
There is some extraordinary material about the way in which soldiers who were incapable of acting were taught first to sew, then to weave, then to farm, and then to carry a gun, and then to shoot it again, as if they're moving from a kind of feminine recuperation to masculine combat status, and that they can go back to the men's war.
The worst cases left doctors grasping for solutions. Electric shock treatment was applied to thousands. Some improved. For the rest, the pain of treatment only added to their misery. But this was not the only experimental method of treating shell shock.
The other method was called so it was the volume of people too that was so difficult for some individuals. You know, what I'm trying to do is not make you feel bad. It's not about, oh, this is a terrible war. What I want to get to is a terrible war, is how the world has dealt with it and what it has meant since that time. And so I have a few other parts to it here. This was something that was one of the hallmarks, like trench warfare, was the use of poison gas, which was widely used on both sides. It would be banned after the First World War, and it's worth noting it wasn't used in the Second World War, despite all of the nothing on the scale like this. Gas masks were very primitive, not always effective. You, of course, weren't necessarily prepared for it. It depended. These are some Irish soldiers preparing, obviously, for an attack. You fire them with artillery shells. Oftentimes, the gas goes where the wind goes. That's, of course, one of those canisters you'd need, and one of the shells there were German. Used again by millions and millions of shells, and different gases had different horrific effects on you. Mustard gas burned anything where there was wetness. You just think of that on your body, your eyes, your ears, your mouth, any opening in your body, or just other places. Canadian soldiers, and of course, you may be blinded. It may kill you. It just depends on what it was. Adolf Hitler, who enthusiastically joined in 1914, was injured in a gas attack, as a number of people were. He recovered. I think he had some damage to his hearing from one of them. All of this is going on for years, to the point where these countries, after 3 or 4 years, are expanding the draft age because they're literally running lower on combat age individuals. And all this time, the United States is not in, which makes sense. Why would you join slaughter like that, this catastrophe? So the question really be, why would you join at all after 3 years? And there's Woodrow Wilson, the president, asking for a declaration of war. We've only had 5 formal wars in our history. We've had a lot of undeclared wars, but why go here after staying out? The United States was neutral, but it wasn't entirely neutral. It wasn't neutral in that it allowed trade between the combatants and the United States. And there was a disproportionate amount of that money that went to England and France in loans and in purchases. Much, much smaller. I mean, huge difference between them and what, say, Germany did. And as you can see from the little graph, as soon as the war started financially, this was an advantage to American producers. And the trade that was running a trade deficit immediately became a surplus, which just began, and this is in the very beginning of the war. By the time of 1917, it's billions of dollars. Now, would a country go to war to protect their trade balance and their loans and protect their banks? And it's a factor. It's definitely a factor. And over the course of the years, even though we were neutral, the government allowed American ships into war zones, and it allowed civilians to travel into war zones, and sometimes civilians got killed, like in the Lusitania, which was an outrageous act. The Germans sinking one of the largest passenger liners. Why did they sink the passenger liner? Hit it with torpedoes. But that would be against the rules of war to carry arms on a passenger liner, and the British denied they had that. But the British, as it turns out, were also breaking the rules of war. So they were using civilians to shield the passage of munitions, the British were, and the Germans broke their rules as well by attacking those ships. You see, they, like the Titanic, they found Lusitania at the bottom of the ocean. But like the Titanic, well, that was an iceberg. Here, 1,200 people died, including 128 Americans. We don't go into the war, but it certainly turns some opinion against Germany, and these things are going to accumulate over time. The Zimmermann telegram Arthur Zimmermann was an ambassador for Germany. The idea of it was absurd. He was going to try and get Mexico and even perhaps Japan to go to war against the United States, and for Mexico, this would occupy the United States. And after the war was over with Germany winning, somehow land that the United States had taken from Mexico would be returned to Mexico, like California and Texas and all the things that were lost in the Mexican War in the middle of the 1800s. It's a farcical idea, but it was an outrageous thing for Americans when they learned about it, that the plot was... The British actually intercepted the telegram and decoded it, and it was tremendous anti-German attitudes that came out of it, that they are trying to invoke war and they're messing in our hemisphere and all that kind of stuff there in 1917.
Question.
Yeah. I don't think they found it until the 1980s. I don't know the condition of it. As I always say, that's a good question. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, right under the shipping schedule of the Lusitania, they placed ads saying, basically, we may attack this ship. But it's kind of that kind of old world, new world kind of thing, that you'd actually tell them you were going to do something like that. But Germany decided this selective fighting, that they gambled. They in 1917 announced this, we're going to attack all ships that we want without whatever the flag that it's flying under. And their gamble was that they would knock out England and France with a blockade of materials before the United States got in, because they assumed this would bring the United States in, because you basically are announcing we're going to be sinking American ships. And it does bring the United States in. Initially, they had some success. As many gambles, they failed. But those combination of things, and Woodrow Wilson's changing his mind over time and deciding that he had an idea of how this post-war world could be different, is what's going to bring him in. So we declare war, and then you go into all the, you kind of reverse course. You had popular songs during the time of neutrality, like I Didn't Raise My Boy to Be a Soldier, saying about how, what kind of a good decision that was. Why would I want to break some other mother's heart? And that's just a little section of the song. I didn't raise him to be a soldier. I brought him up to be my pride and joy. So 2 years later, the much better known Over There, about making your mother proud and getting your gun and going over there, and we're not coming back till it's over there. And that's part of the change that goes on in the United States. And suddenly all the mechanisms of propaganda, and the government sets up a they called it the Creel Committee, and they kind of orchestrated lots of different things through newsreels using actors. That's Douglas Fairbanks, a very well-known actor. Actually, that's Charlie Chaplin as well. I cut up Charlie Chaplin in character and then him out of character, very well-known actor at the time, raising what you might call savings bonds. Typically in wars, they're called war bonds, but for kind of propaganda purposes, call them instead liberty bonds. You're investing in liberty. And as you see, Americans bought billions of these things, or a series of liberty loans. So you're bringing everybody, you know, wake up America and weapons for liberty, and bring along all the people you can, and then convince, of course, people there would be a draft, but also that you need people to enlist. This is 100 years old now. flag did a number of posters, but the I Want You, I think, is so effective. Like a lot of propaganda, it's very simple. It's kind of timeless in this case. He's representing his country, and he's pointing at you, and you either respond to your country or you literally have to turn away from your country. And but as you see, he copied what the British had slightly earlier. There was a whole number of ways of appealing to people to enlist, to be someone, to say something. This, I always like this one, Daddy, what did you do in the Great War? And, you know, what's he going to tell his kids in the future? And you think, wow, what does that have to do with the war? No, no, it's about you. It's like these things, it's about you. And either kind of an appeal to making history, or as it says there, be a man and do it, or, you know, outrage, enlist. It was made in 1916 by an English artist. I'm just appropriating it here, but as you see, it looks like a woman and a child who are drowned with the bubbles. Could be the Lusitania, it could be any ship, but it's pretty effective in that, you know, there's these outrages being committed. Now you got to stand up and do things. And as I said, millions of people will do that. People came to Santa Maria, population about 4,500 people in 1918. They had a one-day, all-day rally. If you could read that well, there was a series of events. They divided up the men, and the women and children did different activities, and then everyone got together at Buena Vista Park and had a big barbecue. The government would encourage communities, again, kind of civic pride. If you could raise the money to buy and pay for a 100-foot flagpole, like Santa Maria did, the government would give you a big flag to wave at the top. And there's the flag waving at Broadway and Main in 1918. And the flagpole is still there. It's just been moved off to the side a little bit. It's not on right on Main anymore, but Los Olivos still has one right in the center, Los Alamos. So they're still around. So it was pretty intensive getting people to be involved. And at the same time, you make your enemy out to be as villainous as possible. And these are all going to have long-term consequences. You know, you'd recognize, of course, the German by the helmet. He's in league with the devil, or he's a bloody, he's the face of death, really. You know, the Hun is a derogatory term for Germans. And so all kinds of anti-German attitudes that took place. And sometimes that just went into straight out lies, as sometimes it does in wars. And these stories of Germans literally crucifying soldiers, completely without evidence, but you have posters showing it. Or this was British, actually, that the Germans were, and that was the translation of it, that they were actually taking their own dead, processing their bodies, and using like the fats and things from the bodies in their war-making materials. That's what the Germans are doing. It's totally made up. It's very effective. When something so outrageous, you're into the 1930s, people were still saying this. And the British government actually in the 1930s formally was saying, it's not true. It's not true, but it had long longevity because, in a sense, people, when you create this hysteria, this dislike, maybe it's possible for this. I mean, this is American propaganda. This is before King Kong. It looks just like him. They're going to destroy Europe, and then they're going to come to the United States. They're going to come across the Atlantic and destroy us. That's a bit of an exaggeration. They're going to burn down New York Harbor. Statue of Liberty going up in flames. They're out for world domination, these monsters. Now, how do you turn that off at some point? Now, when you create this kind of hatred, this kind of, this is what they're doing, that's part of the problem. And, you know, the little things like, well, we don't want to call them Frankfurters because that's a German word. Let's call them hot dogs. sauerkraut, victory cabbage, hamburger Liberty steak. So if you're hungry after this talk and you go to In-N-Out, order a Liberty steak, ask if they have victory cabbage, and say, what? The town of Nordhof was named after a German-American journalist, so the town of Ojai came out of that, which is moon, because they didn't want a German name. And a number of towns changed their names. The people sometimes change their names. Everything German now. German language was banned in many schools. Speaking German was banned in some communities. There were reports of German Shepherd dogs being poisoned. There were the banning of German music. There was all kinds of individuals. This person you see was tarred and feathered because he refused to buy Liberty bonds. His neighbors did that. German fella. Eugene Debs was a three-time presidential candidate who in 1912 got over a million votes. He's a socialist. He criticized the Espionage Act and was arrested for it, for criticizing it. So free speech was under assault. And as you see, the Espionage Sedition Acts, which the government passed, really targeted people who opposed the war, either were conscious objectors, were involved in anti-war movements. So the Constitution becomes something under attack during this time. Debs spent 3 years in jail. He was sentenced to 10 years, but he was pardoned after three. But he went to jail for free speech. And this is all going on. The American entry did make the difference in the war. The German gamble that they would win the war quickly, when you really think about it, this just raised the morale of the French and the English. And then you got all the resources and bodies of these soldiers. This is the first time the United States had ever done this, sent a large group of people overseas to Europe. And it's kind of paving the way for the country becoming the much bigger power that it is. As you see, a lot of first-generation immigrants went back and served. They were paid about $1 a day for their work. And I just kind of just capture the attitude, I think, that helped, you know, that this... We came here to win the war, and they, as I said, did turn the tide. And those kind of quotes, those kind of things, they hadn't experienced the years of stalemate and destruction like that. And so there was a turning of the German offensive. And by late 1918, it seemed more and more clear that Germany itself might get invaded, but they certainly didn't look like they were going to win the Great War after all. The Americans suffered in the time that they served in large numbers. That's a high casualty rate. Now, it's important that Germany and Austria do not surrender. They ask for a ceasefire, and it's important for what happens after that. Even though you could think they were beaten, they asked to have a ceasefire. And by this time, Wilson had what we know in history as his 14 points, this vision of a new world order. And this was part of his idea that this war will be the last war like it, because I have a plan, you know, that we are going to have a fair and just peace. A lot of people interpreted international self-determination to mean an end of colonies. Sounds like we're going to free, let people have their independence. And the United States has colonies by this time, certainly. That's what it seems like he's saying. And it raises a lot of expectations. World of democracy, I guess a world like the United States, and this League of Nations, this diplomatic center where people could get together. Had it existed in 1914, Austria and the Serbs and other, we would have worked out the problems without going to war. And that's his hope. And for the first time, an American president leaves office and goes to Europe while in office. It's so common now. While he's still in office, and he personally is going to negotiate this treaty with a small contingent of Democrats, as he was. So Germany, as you see from the San Luis Obispo Daily Telegram, and and other state papers reporting that, okay, we've got this ceasefire, and now we're going to have a treaty that's going to go. And people were so enthused about Wilson when he came. Hundreds of thousands turned out to see this American president given this welcome with American flags and little French girls and flowers at his feet as he comes in. He shows up in advertising. They're advertising shoe polish, and they're using the president for that. But that anger toward Germany is not gone. You just don't turn it off. That's going to be an issue, certainly. And all of this imagery of murderous baby killers, war criminals, rapists, thugs, never deal with them again. Punish them. And not everybody had the United States point of view of peace without victors, certainly. So they hold it in Versailles outside of Paris, which is probably a bad location because it's so close. It's in France. They probably should have picked a neutral location. Dozens of attendees are at the conference, but basically it's these four people from Italy, France, United Kingdom, and the United States. They're all on the same side. Go back one here. Germany is forbidden to come to the peace treaty. Germany, one of the biggest, most powerful countries that asked for it, they use a blockade on German materials to keep them, they basically would starve them, to keep them from attending the conference. That should be a sign of a huge mistake in the formation. One side will write the treaty, but they don't have agreement. Lloyd George is not in any way going to give up his colonies. England is not going to let the sun set on their empire. George Clemenceau from France, he wants revenge, and he wants to neutralize Germany. They will never be able to invade us again. And they look at this guy, Woodrow Wilson, as he's an idealist. He's from across the water. He doesn't understand what we have gone through. And they have all kinds of conflicts between them as they work on this treaty, which takes months to do. So the world waits. Soldiers slowly go home. And the question is, what was it for? What was all of this suffering for? Isn't that amazing? Bullets. It was in the Battle of Gallipoli. Two hit. Why did the world put Europe and drag others into it? How are you going to explain this to these people? Why did you suffer so enormously? What did we accomplish out of this conflict? British soldiers, all the mud and all that gnome that just churned up land. If you noticed in that Verdun clip, one of the soldiers was stuck in the mud. He was trying to just pull himself out of it. But you have an army of amputees, people that are blind, some are deaf, some have lost limbs, some have lost multiple limbs. These men are learning how to walk, how to go over steps, and go over these things. Explain to them why the war occurred. What was going to happen. Then you have, of course, as I said, the millions of dead. Just nothing on the scale that you've had to this point. And a devastated Europe in large parts. Incalculable, I would imagine, of the just loss, and the loss of history, the loss of tremendous buildings, of art, of just of so many things just destroyed in this. I gave this figure 4 years ago. It's just mind-boggling. If you're born in those three countries and you're male and you're born in those 4 or 5 year period of time, 3/4 of you are dead because you were just that. Those three countries, it's astonishing, a literal lost generation in those quarters. How do you explain this war to the families, to the point. They were given a couple of weeks to take it back to their government and have it signed. One of the members of the German delegation in a couple of days committed suicide. Others were later spat on, and people threw rocks at them because they were blaming them for this. It was a horrible treaty, and it did crazy things. These four men basically had their tea and biscuits and looked over the map of Europe and just drew a bunch of new countries. They took the Austria-Hungary Empire and they dismantled it. It didn't exist anymore. They took the Ottoman Empire, no more. They fought against us. Well, they're gone. Now we have Poland. Now we have what become these Estonian, Lithuanian, as you see, these nine different countries. Putting together a lot of people that don't like each other. You know, the Serbs they don't have independence. They don't have their own country. They're in Czechoslovakia or Yugoslavia. And if you know anything of history, then in the 1990s, there'll be more fighting and ethnic fighting in those areas as some of those countries fall apart. But to just create boundaries, and one thing that particularly affected Germany is that they carved away parts of Germany. They gave part of it to France, and part of it went to this kind of reconstituted Poland. And you're just presented this. These are just the highlights of the treaty. You started the war. Germany did. You don't have any colonies now. You don't have any navy. We're eliminating your navy. You have a token army with all kinds of limits on it as to what kind of armaments you can have. We're going to bill you for a good portion of the war, and they came up with this very high amount of money. And we're going to create a new government and a new capital for you. Well, actually, the capital didn't move, but we're going to. You've never had a history of democratic republic. Well, now you are. And we're just going to give all that. And as you see the areas in the yellow on both sides and the kind of rusty orange, that's all land that's been carved away from Germany. And it just took it. And some of it is very valuable, has a lot of natural resources. The kind of orange part is what France insisted on, a demilitarized zone. And then the French are going to build what they thought was an impregnable defensive line, so we will never get attacked from them again. But they only have a 100,000-man army anyways, so they don't need all these helmets. So France will be safe. That's their thought. As you see, 1 in 10 Germans is now part of another country, along with about that amount of their land. Why didn't this work? What did they create? They didn't create peace. What did they create? Yeah, they created the absolute basis for World War II, and this is a translation of that German saying that basically, we'll get back at you. We'll get back. They humiliated Germany. There's the coffin of Germany and the Allies sitting on it. These monsters, these Allies creating this horrible treaty, they created a document that was immediately hated. And someone like Adolf Hitler could use, someone like Hitler who could come to power saying how truly awful this was, and it really, truly was. Then they just kind of turned their back on the problems that they had created. Wilson had compromised nearly every one of his 14 points. He'd given away, okay, we're not going to end colonies, we're not going to have international self-determination, we obviously don't have peace without victors. But he thought if he could get the League through, then he had still made it worthwhile. But you have to ratify it by the Senate. So he came back. He'd spent months in Europe, back and forth. Now he's crisscrossing the country on this tour. He's promoting the treaty. He's speaking against senators who doubt it or oppose it. He's all over the country. You see him in California. He's in Colorado. He gives a speech. He's traveling by train. He goes to bed, and during the night, he has a mild stroke. And then later, he has a more severe stroke. And he is essentially paralyzed on the left side of his body for a number of weeks. And he will never fully recover from that. about the United States, that immediately weakens the league tremendously, and it never really gets its footing. So what did the United States get of the 14 points? Nothing. What was the war about? A terrible treaty. A treaty of vengeance and humiliation. Now these are things that you can say may have happened without it, but there's a link to it, with the war to it. There had been this temperance movement for many, many years, but as you see, there was a change in the tax collection in just before the war began, and most of the government money came from excise tax, an awful lot of that came from liquor. Now they didn't need that money. But when you think of all the anti-German attitudes and all the German brewers and things, this seemed to be part of the combination that led to Prohibition. I can't say for sure that the war created this. I think it hastened this idea. It had been around since the early 1800s, and it really picked up in the later 1800s, but right after the war, of course, you have Prohibition. A failure, certainly, no question about it, even though there was a lot of enforcement, a whole lot of... How would that picture, that's alcohol being dumped out of a warehouse, how would that be different today? People would be under their little cups, yeah, little red cups. So, but why did Prohibition fail? Because you can't really legislate behavior like that. It created a huge black market, it created all kinds of crime, and it made millions of people criminals by the act of consuming alcohol. And so it will go on till 1933, when it's probably the most unpopular amendment that's ever been put in the Constitution, the only one revoked. But then there's Al Capone and all those various individuals that would take place of legal alcohol for this next decade. This also would have happened at some time. I think the war did hasten this. You're fighting a war, as we said, for democracy, for liberty, for rights, but women can't still vote. And again, this is something for over 70 years women have been lobbying for as groups. And the war, I think, did contribute to finally passing the next amendment, and that was, of course, to give women the vote in 1920. Where everybody then promptly elected this guy president, Warren G. Harding, considered one of our worst presidents. And because there was one of the definite changes that came in the United States from the war was we didn't want this Wilson ideal, international, fix the world kind of thing. We wanted to retreat. And you see Harding's slogan in 1920, America First, which you may have been hearing lately in the paper. About put our interests first, not international treaties, not about getting out in the world. He makes up the word normalcy, and people like that. It just sounded good. Harding is a nice man. He's genial. He was friendly. He was incompetent as a president. But he was really what people were looking for, somebody who's not going to challenge them. We wouldn't have had the Red Scare if you hadn't had the war, because Russia falls into that revolution, and out of that comes the Soviet Union eventually. But we have this general fear not only of communism, but of all things foreign now. We have this reaction to this terrible European involvement. And as you see, the other phrase of law and order, that's what we need, to pull back, to retreat. Sometimes the word is isolate ourselves. And so for the first time, starting in 1921, we put quotas on the number of immigrants from other countries. We never had that. For much of American history, I don't know if it's well known, you didn't need any paperwork to come to the United States. You didn't need a passport. You just walked in. But now we're not only going to require certain things, we're only going to let a certain number of people from each country come in, and that would be maintained into the 1960s. This quota system. And groups like the Klan soar in popularity because their message is anti-foreign. They're anti-black, but they're anti-Jewish, they're anti-Catholic, they're anti so many things. And there's a message of that's what people wanted. If you so I think that's certainly an influence of the war. Clearly, I think as everybody in this room knows, that the Second World War would not have happened had the First World War not occurred. Because, as I said, if for an ultra-nationalist, and there were many in Germany who were bitter, you see, the German Workers' Party was created right at the end of the war, and it reconfigured itself, and if you take the German language, the words for it, it comes out to this National Socialist German Workers' Party, or Nazis for short, and Adolf Hitler quickly joins into it. Finds he has this gift, as he did, for motivating people through his speech, but he had the perfect tool, and he came to power not as much as disliking Jews as he did hating the treaty. And he is elected into his position before he converts it quickly into a dictatorship. These people, these German children, well, one child, one adult, she's burning German money, and they're playing with stacks of German money because it was worthless. They went into a depression. They had this crushing reparations to pay. Their economy, and it just, again, for somebody who says, I have your answers, I have the solution, follow me, it was tailor-made for someone like him. And you can't really conceive of any of that happening without the war. So he comes to power finally as chancellor and then dictator in 1933 and immediately starts to violate every part of the Treaty of Versailles that he can. He reconstitutes the Navy, he expands the military, he builds all kinds of weapons he's not supposed to. How come nobody stops him? Why doesn't France act? Why doesn't Germany? Why doesn't the United States? Why doesn't England? Why don't they act? Well, yeah. How are you going to stop him? Go to another war? Oh, we're not going to do that. In 1927, almost every nation in the world signed the Kellogg-Briand Treaty outlawing war. And if you think about that as kind of a hopeful sort of delusion, let's just outlaw it, and it won't happen. And of course, Hitler put his country on a war economy, and then in 1939, when he'd gone as far as he could, he simply began the Second World War, and which would kill about five times as many people as the First World War. And if you hadn't had the Second World War, you wouldn't have had the Holocaust, and all of those things that went into that, and the millions that died from that. The Jewish population today is still smaller, still today, globally, still smaller than it was in 1939. It has not even recovered those numbers, let alone all the other things that happened. You take all of that out of history, and if you take out World War II, you take out things like Pearl Harbor and the attack by the Japanese. The United States had never had any kind of an attack on this scale, of this type, in its 165 years. And, of course, then the United States is now at war in Asia and against Japan and the Pacific, and then Germany declares war, and we've got two continents and two oceans, all of these things to deal with. Had that not occurred, you wouldn't have had the internment of the Japanese in California, primarily the 120,000 people who were put into camps because of their race, and all of those things that happened connected with that. And you understand how much information and detail could go into any one of these things, wholesale relocation of people to these camps for mostly the duration of the rest of the war. The war ends with the atomic bomb, which I would assume it would have been invented in some fashion, but was first made and deployed at the end of the war, of course, against Japan in Hiroshima and then Nagasaki, going into August of 1945. But if you hadn't had, go back to the Soviet Union, and then the end of the war, and then Franklin Roosevelt's successor, Harry Truman, who really identified the Soviet Union and Joseph Stalin as, well, they're as bad as the Germans and Hitler. So we went almost immediately into a Cold War for the next 50 years with these phrases of containing communism anywhere and everywhere in the world. Otherwise, the domino effect of Treaty of Versailles, Joseph McCarthy had communism. He didn't have evidence, but he could scare the heck out of people by lying, and he did. And it was successful because, you know, better dead than red. And for about 4 years, McCarthy ruined careers and reputations and harmed a lot of people for his own political power. He's a classic demagogue. He played on their fears and prejudices, and so his name essentially is kind of like a political witch hunt. And there he is with Roy Cohn, one of the lawyers, primary lawyers that worked with him during this era. So you wouldn't have had that, and you certainly wouldn't have had the hot wars of the Cold War if you didn't have the Soviet Union, which you wouldn't have had if you hadn't had World War I. And so you wouldn't have had the Korean and the Vietnam War for the United States. 35,000 Americans die in Korea, 58,000 in Vietnam, but in civilians, you're looking at about 3 million people died in those two conflicts. So, and you could go on, you know, with this legacy. You can make a case, I think, about even conflicts in the Middle East because of things that happened. But let's go back to the war here for a second, since it's 2 days away. It was originally called Armistice Day because it was the ceasefire day. It became, in this country, the more broad, as you see, Veterans Day for all wars, all veterans, in war or not. In England, it's Remembrance Day or Poppy Day, typically, and at the beginning of the 100th anniversary of the beginning of the war, they had this very dramatic, amazing, nearly 900,000 ceramic poppies that they placed outside, and you see the Queen wearing the poppies. And the reason for the red poppies is the red symbolizes blood, and poppies were one of the first flowers that grew in no man's land, in the trenches. They just popped right up here. There's always something like this, but I actually just learned this today. And I get these thoughts, you know. There's got to be here. Yeah, the last person killed in World War I was actually, ironically, a German-American from Baltimore, as you see, who had recently been demoted. And what I read was that he engaged in this rather fruitless and life-taking charge, a one-man run at the lines, because he wanted to regain his rank before, and he thought maybe if he did something heroic. The German gunners tried to wave him. Someone shot him, and it was 1 minute before the armistice. Since it was a ceasefire at 11 a.m., as we know, on the 11th hour, the 11th day, the 11th month, the war and the guns went silent. So he is apparently the last person killed out of those 10 million. That day, 11,000 people died on the last day, you know. But, and that's the thing, it's always one of the hard things in teaching is how do you, you know, the scale of things. I can't understand 10 million. What if I said it was 5 million? Is that half as bad? In terms of death, I can't really explain that kind of thing. So I like to look at a little personal stuff, like, you know, we're still identifying remains of people long after because it's important for descendants, and occasionally they figure out remains of individuals. Now, we have reached a point where no one in that war, no one in the world is alive. Frank Buckles was the last American. As you see, he died at the age of 110. Florence Green was the last of anybody known to be actually connected. She was a teenager, and she worked in an office, and she's British. And you see, she died the next year after Frank. And I put in Emma Moreno. She's the last human being to live in the 1800s. She was born in 1899, and you see, lived to be 117. She retired when she was 65. And so she ate one hard-boiled egg and two raw eggs every day. She did not like fruit or vegetables. Just a tip. If you want to do that, and I left it out, but I could have shown this when they gave her a birthday cake. What was was on it? Strawberries. Strawberries. She doesn't like strawberries. Anyways, we like strawberries. So no one from the war, no one even from that previous century is alive. But, you know, the legacies that you have. John McCrae, as you see, was a physician, and he was Australian, and he was treating a friend who died. And he wrote what is probably the most famous bit of writing about the war in Flanders Fields, and it's just one of the lines about it. As I said, those red poppies, that's a reenactment of trenches, and those red poppies that grow there. He, as you see, did not survive the war. His voice was still, but I had the director of PCPA read in Flanders Fields in 1914. Now there's a guy, Mark Boer, if you know him, and there's a man with a voice that was powerful. But you can read it, and it's still very good. But, you know, he was lost. There's Field of Poppies in England. Yeah. Wilfred Owen is another poet. He's British. He wrote a number, many, many poems. You could find both these guys very easily. That part where he's saying it's sweet and honorable to die for one's country, he is being completely bitter and sarcastic about it. He's saying that it's kind of like this section of this poem, it's pointless. And when people die, nobody even notices. They just die. And as you see, he was killed 1 week before the battle, before the war ended. And it seemed to just go on that line of what was the point? I'm not sure. But he wrote during the war. He suffered from shell shock. He spent at one point 4 days in a foxhole he could not escape from because of all the fighting going on, the shelling. But he had to live those 4 days around a dismembered body. And it was just extremely difficult for him. But he did leave a number of poems. There's some very poignant ones if you want to take a look at them. Obviously, there are the battlefields as a legacy in Verdun and many other places, just as we have Civil War battlefields. And still lumpy from all the craters, from all the shells. To this day, in Europe, as I said, there's all this unexploded ordnance. They still dig it up. I found that amazing. One farm, one season, all that shells. Sometimes people get killed, even today, from some of this. You can see the warning signs. I guess it's okay for the sheep, or they're not heavy, or they don't care. I don't know. But it's still there. And they'll sometimes they find gas shells. And then you can't just blow those up. You have to dispose of them differently. But for those people who, you know, like the wounded, in whatever the way they were wounded, and this, you know, the war's over. War's over. Move on. How do you move on? And how does society move on? The facial wounds, they're tremendous. And there are far, far worse images photographs of people with facial wounds. Most of them are not really treated. There's not plastic surgery. This is kind of the inspiration for the origins of reconstructive surgery. But they can't do the kinds of things that they can now. So people like Anna Coleman were employed to help a small number of them to take pre-war photographs and to fashion little masks that they would then fit on these people, and you can see like these, over their faces. As I said, to give them a semblance of, you know, dignity, and they can go out in public. And you're going to be wearing this the whole time, and your chin may be gone, you may not have a nose, you may not have ears. But these kinds of things were given to hundreds of soldiers, although many, many were not given these. It's rather extraordinary. A few years ago, there was a television series on HBO called Boardwalk Empire, and one of the characters was one of those guys, and I thought it was amazing, well done. And occasionally he takes off his mask. He was a sniper, is the story. He takes off, and they this hellacious wounds. He has no eye, his face is half gone, but he would wear that. And it's a remarkable character that I was looking at. But he also suffers from shell shock character as you have here. Some people didn't shy away at all. Otto Dix was a German artist. For whatever his motives, for him it was therapeutic, if it was something he couldn't escape, if he wanted the world to see, but he made these horrible images of what people had. Here you have an amputee who looks like he may be blind and obviously is destitute, hoping to sell something, and everyone just ignoring him, and literally a dog peeing on the person. And this post-war attitude that, the world has just gone and turned their way from all that we did. There are these others. These also just happen to be German artists. But, and I'm talking again about loss and legacy, and these are, as you see, some of their pre-war art. These two artists they knew each other, and they sometimes showed together, and they're part, of course, Germany's very vigorous art and philosophical, intellectual community, country, and this, some people have said, is maybe the beginnings of what Cubism became. It's certainly modern art for the age, this expressivism that these two guys were doing. And they did, again, you can see their art online. They did a number of paintings. And, kind of the graphics of it. This one called the Eight Freeze. See the kind of angular things like what Picasso eventually is going to do, and others there. Both these men ended up going into the service, as so many German men did, and both of them were killed. And it's just the losses of, and you say the millions of people and all their skills and attributes and lives and the families and the things they would have added instead of subtract. And just as examples of things that were taken, and I really like that picture of August there, the way he looks at the camera. He's a young guy, but died in the first year in a bombardment. This is something that is much less known, because I never heard of it till this last summer, and I don't know how many have. And that there, of course, were the trenches. But there were also quarries, large underground areas that were used to house soldiers under battlefields. And an American physician, a doctor named Jeff Guskey, who's also a skilled amateur photographer, got access to these. He said they're pretty well protected by the families that own them, because they don't want, they're not for tourists, most people don't know the location, they don't want vandalism. They're completely unlit, and so Guskey had to take some classes, as he said, learn how to do what he described as Rembrandt lighting, to be able to light these areas so he could photograph them. But hundreds and collectively thousands of soldiers spent some time in these quarries that had been, of course, dug out for the rock just because of their location. And while they were there, they chiseled into the walls. These stairways led out into the battlefield, so you were literally, you could be feet from death, and so soldiers that called it Stairways to Heaven. He just took this picture last year, and the Smithsonian has an exhibit that runs at least through Sunday on his art there, and the things that people did while they were under there. It's not hard rock. And they some of them had some real, these are all soldiers, obviously, and their talents and the things they could express, love and sexuality. It says for God and USA in the upper left. So he's gone to a number of these quarries, and there were different countries represented, and he has this incredible a soldier. I don't know if it's a self-portrait or something, but this is not a corroded worn. This is one of those, a soldier who's had half his face blown off, and someone drew it or carved it, and just left these things down there for a century. An altar right by the stairs. And you can see the cross and the sun and all. And it looks like some other news. Yeah. So as I said, these would be completely in the dark now, and this is a Jewish altar. And it's just an amazing kind of stuff that he's found. That he does forever. And then there's art by soldiers, just like the two that I showed you, the Germans, that survived, that represents what they were experiencing at the time when they're there. I don't know if, I haven't looked actually, if these people were trained, if they, what their background is. They obviously have talent, but they're documenting the world that's around them. And this was another thing that was being shown at the Smithsonian that I thought was really remarkable, having the soldiers' point of view of their own work. That one, like some of those are actually lights in the background that I caught in the camera, but it kind of looks like the flare, so I'll go with that one. This is you've seen, some of you probably have seen this, All Quiet on the Western Front, and the story which came out, and the film came out, you see, in 1930. If there's an answer to what the war was about, it had no answer. It was about nothing good. Nothing good came out of it. Only really bad things came out of it. Truly horrible, large bad things came out of it. A century legacy of problems that some we still deal with. But this was back in 1920s when a book came out and then the film made, telling the story of a German soldier, Paul, who is very enthusiastic when he enlists in 1914. And then as he goes to the war, he becomes more and more disenchanted with what he sees and experiences. And this is very late in his story. He's back on the front in the trenches, and his happenings here. Where am I at here? Innocence, Paul just forgets for a moment. If you knew that at the time, that you'd recognize that sniper was a French soldier by his helmet. And but Paul's death is for what reason? No reason. He just died. Just like Wilfred Owen was saying, just as all of them were saying, just as John McCrae was saying, and kind of forgotten because there were so many of them. And I mean, the film really holds up, but a strong anti-war statement in between the two world wars. And the battle scenes, I think, are remarkable for the years when it happened. The actor who played Paul apparently had difficulty, because the role was so hard for him, and just the whole thing of what he went through. And what you saw at the very end were all characters during the film, and they'd all one by one been killed, and they're turning back and looking at you as they walk to their ever-ending. And that's, I think, why we should remember World War I, because, I don't believe history repeats, but I do think human behavior repeats, and we do need to be on guard for all of these things, for demagogues, for people making poor decisions, for people making absurd decisions, and populations kind of going along with them. When you think this all started, I mean, in a way, Adolf Hitler came to power because somebody couldn't deal with a 19-year-old with a handgun, and all the things that happened after that. And so, in 2 days' time, I know, most people see this a long weekend, and I do too. But it's something to at least remark on in your mind. So that's all I have, really. This is what I like is this one. These German, as you see, these mourning parents. I like the angle of them being turned away from us because they're looking at their son. He's in one of those graves there. But that's really all that you have after this war is memories and loss and having to deal with that, and then society just moving on. And you're just kind of left to yourself, and that's what unfortunately can happen in things like that. So I thank you. Have you any questions or anything of those?